Hi, and welcome to this edition of the Our Catholic Prayers podcast. I'm Christopher Castagnoli for OurCatholicPrayers.com. Please note that in addition to this episode on the Magnificat, we invite our listeners to check out some of our other podcasts on our Blessed Mother, including those on the prayers Hail Mary, Regina Caeli, and Stabat Mater. We also have a podcast that features a rosary meditation on Mary's Assumption into Heaven, and one entitled, The Month of May is the Month of Mary. God bless. And now, on to the Magnificat. The Magnificat, taken from Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, verses 46 to 55, is the Blessed Virgin Mary's hymn of praise to the Lord. It is also known as the Canticle of Mary in the Liturgy of the Hours, which is a special collection of scripture readings, psalms, and hymns that constitute what is known as the Prayer of the Church. Priests and other religious are required to pray sections from the Liturgy of the Hours each day. Although the Magnificat has had numerous musical settings, from such composers as Palestrina, Bach, and Mozart, it can be recited as well as sung. Its name comes from the first line of its text in Latin, Magnificat anima mea Dominum, translated in the first line. Mary proclaims the Lord's greatness with characteristic humility and grace. And now the prayer itself follows. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, because he has regarded the lowliness of his handmaid. For behold, henceforth all generations shall call me blessed, because he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is from generation to generation on those who fear him. He has shown might with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the conceit of their heart. He has put down the mighty from their thrones, and has exalted the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has given help to Israel, his servant, mindful of his mercy, even as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his posterity forever. The Magnificat provides great material for meditation on the Visitation, the second joyful mystery of the Rosary. When the angel Gabriel informs Mary that she is to be the Mother of God, he also tells her of her cousin Elizabeth's pregnancy with John the Baptist. After Mary gives her famous consent to becoming the Mother of God, "Behold the handmaid of the Lord, be it done to me according to thy word," as we read in Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 38. She goes with haste, as Luke says in chapter 1, verse 39, to help Elizabeth, who is delighted to see her. Our Lady then expresses her joy in the Magnificat. We can admire Mary's devotion, as well as her stamina, in setting out on what must have been an arduous journey to go from Nazareth, where she lived, to a town in Judah where her cousin lived, about 70 miles away. Remember, this was in an era long before anyone could hop in a car or a bus or a train to get there. Clearly, Mary, in hastening to help her cousin, is focused on service to others. In this way, she glorifies the Lord in reflecting and magnifying his goodness and love. And of course, by becoming the Mother of God, she will help him redeem us for our salvation in his passion. Speaking of magnifying, Archbishop Fulton J. Sheen once referred to our Blessed Mother as being like, as he put it, a magnifying glass that intensifies our love for her Son. Note that Mary's joyful claim that all generations shall call me blessed in no way takes away from her humility. If she seems to boast here, inasmuch as St. Paul does later on in Scripture when he says, "Whoever boasts should boast in the Lord." This is taken from his second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 10, verse 17. This is to say, in God's work being done through us. In this regard, the Magnificat is more than a prayer of praise. It also reminds us about the essential link between humility and holiness. Just as God has regarded the lowliness of his handmaid and has done great things for Mary in making her the mother of his son, so too has he put down the mighty from their thrones with his own might and has exalted the lowly. Note also our Blessed Mother's humility in referring to herself in this prayer, as she does in giving her consent to Gabriel, mentioned earlier, as the Lord's handmaid, his servant. As her divine Son later stressed, "Whoever exalts himself shall be humbled, and whoever humbles himself shall be exalted." This is taken from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 23, verse 12, also in slightly different words in Luke's Gospel, chapter 18, verse 14, and chapter 14, verse 11. Jesus wasn't saying anything new here either. We read similar thoughts throughout the Old Testament, such as in the Psalms and in this example from the book of Sirach. "Humble yourself the more, the greater you are, and you will find favor with God." This is taken from Sirach chapter 3, verse 19. The line about God filling the hungry with good things resonates later in the Gospels as well, when our Lord says, "Blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they will be filled." This is taken from Matthew's Gospel chapter 5, verse 7. This serves as a good reminder for us to stay hungry, as the expression goes, for God's graces in praying and in reading His Word in Scripture. And as for the rich being sent away empty, this line refers to those who live for wealth and power and feel they have everything figured out. These people, in effect, wish to be gods, G-O-D-S, rather than gods, G-O-D apostrophe S. How can our Lord fill those who are already full of themselves? How about you? Does your soul magnify the Lord? We may never be able to approach Him from Mary's level of sanctity as the Mother of God. Still, we are called to be saints nonetheless. Your good example, like our Blessed Mother's, can help others in their spiritual growth. Do people see Christ's love and goodness in you? Are you letting God work within you to accomplish His will? Let Mary help give you the graces you need to follow her Son and His Church in praying the Magnificat. As St. Ambrose once said in referring to this wonderful prayer, "Let Mary's soul be in us to glorify the Lord. Let her spirit be in us that we may rejoice in God our Savior." Thanks for listening. This is Christopher Castagnoli for OurCatholicPrayers.com. Until next time, God bless.